Hello, I'm Sumi Somaskanda. From the BBC World Service, this is The Global Story. The relationship between the United States and China has long been tense. Diplomatic relations have continually been strained and then strengthened. And the past decade has been no different. Despite his public admiration for President Xi Jinping, Donald Trump was uncompromising when he imposed trade tariffs on China amid a record trade deficit. Under the Biden administration, meaningful communications between the nations were at one stage effectively frozen. And despite a limited rapprochement in the past year, progress appears to have been undermined behind the scenes. So what would a Harris or Trump White House mean for relations between the US and China? Today, in a new special pre-election report looking at America's place in the world ahead of the U.S. election, we are in three different locations. I am in Washington, D.C. Our China correspondent, Laura Bicker, is in Beijing. Hi, Laura.
Hello, Sumi. Good to talk to you.
And our business correspondent, Michelle Fleury, is in New York. Hi, Michelle.
Hi, Sumi. Good to be with you.
Great to have you both with us. And Laura, you know, I want to start with the fact that obviously here in the U.S., there is a lot of attention on the upcoming election with just a few weeks till people go to the polls. You are a former Washington correspondent. Is the U.S. getting much attention in Chinese media right now?
So it does a little, especially when there's big moments. When Biden bowed out for the race, for instance, it went viral across Chinese social media. Now, remember, there are nearly a billion Chinese social media users, so they're all on there chatting away about what this might mean. I think the main thing that people here are concerned about is their own Chinese economy. And in that sense, when it comes to the likes of the presidential debates, for instance, there was a lot of close scrutiny when it comes to talks about tariffs, for instance, because that is key for those who are worried about the Chinese economy.
Yeah, and Laura, that brings me to another question. I know it's a big one, but how would you define U.S.-China relations right now?
Whew, big deep breath for this one. I think it's a lot better than it was. Look, 2 years ago, there was very little communication between Washington and Beijing. Things were at a dangerous point. And that came after Nancy Pelosi, the former speaker, visiting Taiwan.
We didn't go there to talk about China. We went there to praise Taiwan. We went there to show our friendship, to say China cannot isolate Taiwan. So that's what it was about.
It came after the Chinese spy balloon floating over North America and then being shot down.
I told them to shoot it down.
On Wednesday.
Like a recommendation.
They said to me, let's wait till the safest place to do it.
Now, why is it important that the US and China talk? Well, they are intricately involved, whether they like it or not, when it comes to the economy, when it comes to trade, and also when it comes to military interactions. The two come very, very close to one another in the likes of the South China Sea. And one of the key concerns when it came to that was what would happen if there was a real flashpoint. Would they be able to communicate? They have clawed a way back since then. And Antony Blinken, the US Secretary of State's visit earlier this year was successful, but even more successful was the National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan's visit just a few months ago. It's never going to be an ideal relationship. I think the best that they can hope for is to stop this intensely competitive relationship veering into any conflict.
There have been in the past few years, in particular, numerous examples of China really painted as a clear adversary. Do you think, Michelle, that this relationship is on voters' minds?
If you'd asked me this question maybe 4 years ago, I would have said it was absolutely top of voters' mind. But right now, there are other more pressing issues, much like the picture Laura just painted in China. Front of minds for most people is the economy. In fact, there was a National Security Action Survey carried out recently about what voters worried about most when it came to national security, and only 14% of respondents picked China as their top issue. If you look back, there was a Pew survey separately that showed that I think 42% of Americans view China as an enemy. So some strong feelings there. It's just there are other issues right now that feel more pressing to the average American.
Yeah, that is a remarkable number indeed. And Laura, coming back to you, President Xi Jinping, you know, we know that he held this high-level meeting with President Biden in November. Under China's current leadership, how much is the fate of diplomatic relations determined just by him?
Well, Sumi, you're right, because you look at this change of leadership, you've got this democratic process in the United States where there's a race for the White House. Here, there is one man in charge. Everything comes from President Xi. What they've done here is kind of foster this feeling of Chinese pride. And I think that's maybe what many Americans see as a threat. This is, make no mistake about it, this is a country that really wants to not be the world's second economy. It wants to be the first, and they are working towards that. And President Xi's view is that the West is declining and the East is rising. But there are signs that he does want to do business on his terms. For instance, there were a whole bunch of US businesses invited to China. They were welcomed with open arms. He talked about cooperation. He talked about being friends again. So when it comes to kind of wooing American businesses, he's very much on friendly terms. But that is because, make no mistake about it, that's because China's economy is declining. It is not advancing at the rate it was before. And President Xi knows that he needs to keep the economy stable if he's to keep the country stable.
Michelle, as Laura said, we're talking about the two largest economies in the world. If we just take a step back, tell us more about these economies. What characterizes them? What makes them successful or not?
And if you look at the US, it is still the world's largest economy in GDP terms. And it is larger than China by quite a margin. Now, it got to that off the back of being dominant in things like manufacturing and heavy industry. But if you look at modern America today, that's not so much the case. Where it kind of leads is in things like advanced technology, and it's the service sector that is driving the US. China, which is the world's second largest economy, is powered by heavy industry and by manufacturing. But if you project into the future, Sumi, the Chinese population is huge, and the sheer size of the consumer market there will dwarf the size of the United States. And so the population and the demographics are something that work in China's favor, at least in the long term.
Michelle, we hear a lot about the trade deficit here in the US. That's a big part of the political discussion as well. What is it, and why is it concerning to some US lawmakers?
The US has had this trade deficit for a long time, and the biggest piece of that has been with China. In other words, it imports more from China than it exports there. And in particular, this is something that has been a bugbear for Donald Trump. He's been determined to try and change that dynamic. And he has settled on this idea of tariffs.
We've developed a great relationship with China, other than the fact that they've been killing us on trade for the last long period of time.
But there's a slight problem with that. If you listen to economists, they will tell you that it also acts in some ways as a domestic tax, because the majority of imports into America from China are what you call unfinished goods, things that are maybe raw materials or a screw that might go into another product. And then that added price ultimately goes into that US good.
Laura, when we have this conversation about these two economies, how they stack up against each other, how they work together or don't in the case of tariffs, what are the key industries from China's perspective here?
It's really interesting to hear Michelle talk about what's coming from China, because when you speak to American businesses here, the key thing that they talk about is the China shock. And I think there was a real shock right across the West when China started exporting cheap goods, so cheap furniture, cheap toys. I think what you're seeing now is China trying to ramp up more high-level goods, and those are electric cars and solar panels. The worry is this second China shock, that China will dump all of this into the United States.
China has been very effective, as Laura was saying, at investing in specific industries. And I think you're seeing the Biden administration has cottoned onto that. They've recently introduced 100% tariffs on electric vehicles from China. And it's interesting that you're seeing the kind of approach from the Donald Trump administration through to the current administration carry on. There is a through line between the two in how they are kind of viewing China as a competitive threat.
What about the candidates here? Because some analysts have observed that Kamala Harris and Donald Trump have fairly similar economic policy promises when it comes to China.
They both share the view that China is a threat. Donald Trump, we know that he wants to impose minimum of 60% tariff on goods coming in from China, and he wants to make sure that America is the dominant player going forward. In the case of Kamala Harris, the assumption is that she will carry on perhaps some of the Biden administration's approach, and that is what Joe Biden has called competition, not conflict. You're starting to see the U.S. Impose tariffs on technology that might help China get there. So I'm thinking about things like semiconductor chips. I'm thinking of NVIDIA, which is at the forefront of making chips used for artificial intelligence. There is a ban on them being able to sell those to the Chinese.
So we've taken a look at the current state of relations between the U.S. and China and considered how that impacts trade between the world's two largest economies. Next, how this delicate relationship affects global security. Laura, the obvious place to start is the United States' position on Taiwan. This is such a tense issue. We often talk about the status quo. Tell us what that means and also how it is increasingly a bone of contention between China and the U.S.
When it comes to Taiwan, China sees this the democratic island of Taiwan as part of its own territory. They refuse to recognize the president. They believe that Taiwan is part of the mainland. President Xi has vowed to reunite Taiwan with the mainland using force if necessary. Now, that is where the key point comes in, because that is where the United States, certainly under Joe Biden, has said, well, if that is the case, if China use military, we will defend it. However, when it comes to the US's official position, they take this one China policy to maintain relations with Beijing. They will maintain that Taiwan is part of China, but at the same time, what they use is a term called strategic ambiguity. They kind of walk this narrow line between the two to avoid annoying Beijing, but also to say, well, hang on a second, should we protect Taiwan? And that has been the difference under the Biden administration. What they've done in this region has been quite remarkable. It's been very, very slow, very steady over the last 4 years. You have seen them build military ties with Philippines. So that's some of the closest areas to Taiwan. The Americans now have access to four new bases. You've then seen them develop relationship between South Korea and Japan. Now, South Korea and Japan might be US allies, but they are thorny allies between themselves. You've seen this alliance building right across Asia. Now, China looks at this and is a bit worried and says, hang on a second, is this a new version of a kind of East Asia NATO? And that has created several problems between Washington and Beijing. It's thought certainly here that Kamala Harris will kind of maintain the Biden administration approach. But she hasn't actually said she will come to the aid of Taiwan. She's maintained a little bit of ambiguity about that. When it comes to Donald Trump, he doesn't perhaps see it in the same way as other presidents have in the past, or certainly as Joe Biden does, that perhaps this is an island that needs to be fostered for its democracy. He sees it as a business competitor. And I think perhaps those in Taiwan would be very nervous about a second Donald Trump presidency.
There are some here in the US who insist that China is a direct security threat to the United States, especially when it comes to modern warfare, artificial intelligence, hacking, spyware, and so on. Does that really put an obstacle in the way of any sort of meaningful cooperation with China, regardless of who the candidate is?
Look, I think Mark Cuban is a billionaire investor here in America. He's been speaking a lot on behalf of Kamala Harris as a sort of one of her boosters from the business community. And in an interview, he recently said, whoever leads or whoever wins in artificial intelligence will lead militarily. In addition to that, you've also got the sort of hacking side of things. I mean, it was only a couple of weeks ago that the FBI director, Christopher Wray, was talking about an incident collecting information from US companies, US politicians, and it was sharing them with government agencies back in China. So remember last year, we saw that Microsoft hack by Chinese that infiltrated government email accounts. It is that idea that somehow it could control, gather information, but also control infrastructure and shut down things like the electricity grid in the future. That's the kind of warfare that, that kind of military experts are talking about and are concerned about.
Against that backdrop, Michelle, if you look at the campaign trail, how much are Kamala Harris and Donald Trump actually talking about China right now?
I think he's mentioned it about 40 times on the campaign trail in his five rallies since the presidential debate. But then just last week in one of his town hall meetings, he brought it up 27 times. She hasn't mentioned China at all in her six initial rallies. So there is a big difference there. And I think it goes to show sort of what their bases are most concerned about and what plays with them.
Laura, do you have the sense that Chinese authorities have a preference between Donald Trump or Kamala Harris?
To me, one of my favorite quotes from an analyst that I got in the last few months was that they felt that it was a choice between two bowls of poison. That's China's prevailing view when it comes to the US presidential election. They don't see anything changing anytime soon. Having said that, there was a kind of prevailing view amongst some analysts that perhaps China would prefer Donald Trump, because it would cause a little bit of chaos, perhaps diplomatically. I mean, last time Donald Trump was president, he met Kim Jong-un three times. I think that when it comes way back to what Chinese people are most concerned about, and that is the economy. And the fear is that a Donald Trump presidency would mean more tariffs. And I think perhaps if you were to push people, they might say, well, maybe Kamala Harris will be slightly better in that regard, maybe more stable in that regard when it comes to whether or not there'll be another trade war between the United States and China.
To what extent does the president even dictate this relationship? We know that there are economic ties. Big tech business leaders are arguably equally influential, aren't they?
They are. I mean, look, I think on the presidential side, obviously, tariffs have proven popular because it's something that the White House can do without needing congressional approval. In terms of companies, the truth of the matter is China's middle class alone is bigger than the population of the United States. And so because of that, it is a prize that they can't turn away from.
One of the phrases I keep hearing is the US-China relationship is the most consequential relationship in the world. And it's not just because of geopolitics. It is because of the economy and the global economy. And the US-China relationship can have, whether it's going well or whether it's going badly, really has an impact on many people's lives.
The most consequential relationship in the world. Certainly very high stakes for this upcoming presidential election. Okay, thank you, Laura. Thank you, Michelle. Such an interesting conversation.
Thank you, Sumi.
Thanks.
If you want more episodes of The Global Story, you can find us wherever you get your podcasts. Every day, we dive deep into a single story, bringing you in-depth analysis from around the world. Subscribe so you can make sure you never miss an episode. Thank you for watching The Global Story.